I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter.
You're listening to CheapGeek Podcast. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/CheapGeek. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. So it begins again. Welcome back to the CheapGeek Podcast. This is episode number 55.
Little Folk, Wind Noise, The 50 Least Powerful People, and Middle Finger Lady.
Yeah. So we're welcome, can't talk today. So welcome back and thanks for listening to CheapGeek Podcast. This is episode number 55, and if you are tuning in today, very much appreciate it.
Yeah.
Got a whole lot of stuff to talk about. Most of it seemingly unrelated. If you're first time tuning into the CheapGeek Podcast, just be aware that we find things we think to be interesting, and we talk about them in great and agonizing detail in hopes that you find some sort of amusement out of it.
Oh.
Dirty little secret is, we don't care if you do. Yeah. Hang on, what do you think about that?
Interesting.
Yeah.
But again, if you're tuning in, thanks. And please note that you can call the show. You can give us a call at 575-208-4025. Go ahead and call and leave us a message or some feedback or comments or whatever.
Yeah, we appreciate it.
Yep.
So let's talk a little bit about some things I think is interesting.
Okay.
Yeah. I came across this and I thought this was actually pretty interesting. This is the 50 least powerful people in the world.
But wouldn't that just be like 90% of the world?
Probably more than that. You know.
Okay.
Yeah. There's some rules to it, I guess.
Oh.
Okay, these are people that used to be powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And for whatever reason, they are not.
Oh,
you know what
okay.
I mean? Like they were, but they've done something or something's happened and now they're not.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, seeing this little article, it's off 24/7 Wall Street, you know?
Yeah.
And it kind of talks about fame, fortune, and power in all of its forms are glorified in the American culture. Entire media networks are dedicated to covering blah, 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 blah. But anyway, power can be fleeting, right? Circumstances can change rapidly. Fortunes can be lost overnight. And the masters of the universe today can wind up unemployable tomorrow. Yeah.
Oh.
And this is where this comes from.
Oh, and this is from, okay.
This is relatively recent.
Yeah. It's interesting, though, because like, they have James Comey on here from the FBI.
Yeah, well, here let's do it in order. And we're not going to do all 50 because we have lives to lead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you want to do the second one? I'll do the first one.
Okay.
Okay.
Chris Christie.
What?
Yes.
What did I just say? I'll do the first one.
Oh, you said, well, he's number two.
What?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Governor
let's,
of New
let's,
Jersey.
Let's, yeah. No, let's do number one first.
Okay.
And then number two. Follow logical progression here. Okay?
Uh-huh.
All right. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. So the first one is Anthony Scaramucci. You know that guy?
Yeah.
He went around very long.
No, he wasn't.
Yeah.
White House Communications Director. He got fired in July of 2017, less than 2 weeks after his appointment.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's pretty much the shortest term of any communications.
He's like, hey, I'm Scaramucci.
Bye.
Hey, this guy. Every time this guy talks, it reminds me of like, hey, I'm Jimmy Baker Donuts, you know?
Yeah.
And it was like, okay, so he did his thing, and it was pretty tumultuous, right?
Yeah.
And short. And his highlights, or the highlights of his tenure, right?
Yeah.
Included the apparent protocol breaches with the FBI, conflicting statements about his relationship with then-Chief of Staff Priebus, mm-hmm. profanity-laced interview with The New Yorker, in which he spoke ill of other Trump administration officials, including Priebus and Chief Strategist Steve Bannon, right?
Yeah.
And during all this, his wife filed for divorce. So this dude's
that
just
dude
like...
That dude had a bad 2 weeks.
Yeah, you know, I'm like... Yeah. So I was like, wow, that's... And you know, I totally forgot about that dude until I read this. I'm like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you read number two.
Well, number two is, again, it's Chris Christie, governor of New Jersey. He was also a contender for the 2016 Republican presidential nomination. He had the lowest approval ratings of any governor in the country and in the history of all of New Jersey. It's not hard to see why, according to this article. The lame duck two-term governor fawned over Donald Trump after the bombastic billionaire won the presidential election. So this is a little bit of a biased article.
Yep.
But my biggest thing was during Trump's campaigning, he did pick on Chris Christie a little bit.
Yeah.
I kind of felt bad for him.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah. Everybody picks on Christie.
So everybody thinks that, or, you know, many speculated that Christie was angling for a post in the new administration. Trump did name Christie to head of his transition team, but eventually replaced him with Mike Pence.
Yeah.
Yeah. In the end, Trump decided not to include Christie in his cabinet, possibly because Christie was damaged goods. That's terrible. Christie's reputation was sullied by the Bridgegate scandal. And, oh.
Yeah, remember that?
No, not really. I didn't hear about that.
Yeah.
But apparently something about a traffic jam, George Washington Bridge in early September 2013. And...
He was hoping... Yeah. He was hoping that the motorists would blame a local Democratic mayor for the big traffic jam. And it was him.
Oh, okay. Yeah. The outgoing governor said he didn't care about poll numbers, and that seemed to be the case with last month. Christie and his family were spotted lounging on a state-owned beach while the general public was denied beach access due to a statewide government shutdown.
Yep.
Ooh, that's kind of bad.
It is kind of bad. Number three is also kind of bad. This butthead, mm-hmm. James Comey, director of the FBI.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's been a controversial figure since the middle of August.
Yeah.
I mean, middle of August, since the middle of the 2016 presidential election, right?
Mm-hmm.
Initially, he was criticized for publicly attacking Democratic candidate Hillary Clinton's judgment and use of a private email server during our time at the State Department, right?
Yeah.
And then he basically garnered even more ire when, in an apparent break from Bureau protocol, he announced that candidate Clinton was the subject of an FBI investigation only days before the election.
Yeah.
Okay. While some attribute President Donald Trump's electoral victory to Comey's investigation of Clinton, Trump abruptly fired the FBI director less than 5 months into his presidency.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he had served as the FBI director since 2013, when he was appointed by President Barack Obama, until he was terminated by Trump in 2017, and the White House has since provided multiple justifications to his firing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I watched those hearings and seen what was reported, and the dude kind of was a liar.
Mm.
And kind of got caught being a liar, amongst other things. So.
And
he's got his own little history.
What I found interesting was a break in Bureau protocol my thing is, as a citizen, I'd kind of want that transparency.
Well,
you know,
yeah.
I want to know I'm not voting for somebody.
Well, the timing is wrong, because, I mean, it looks like, you know, it's a sabotage sort of attempt.
Well, that's true.
You know,
yeah.
Towards, political party or whatever. It just looks bad. It looks like one side's attacking the other and all that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And it looks a little underhanded,
okay.
You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's kind of like, okay. And then here's one I thought was actually pretty good. Mark Fields.
Yeah.
He's the CEO of Ford Motor Company.
Yeah, formerly.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's what he was. Yeah. Basically, Fields had been with Ford since 1989. He worked his way up to chief operating officer in 2012 and then CEO in 2014.
Yeah.
And his time at the top was limited largely due to his failure to inspire confidence on Wall Street. Ford shares fell nearly 40% during his tenure as CEO.
So in 3 years, they fell 40%?
Yeah.
Holy damn.
And then even as corporate revenue climbed to over 5% from 2014-2016, shareholder confidence was mostly undermined by Fields' determination to take on Tesla. Right?
Yeah.
And investing in electric and autonomous vehicle technology, despite attempts to woo shareholders by announcing a 10% reduction in its global workforce, right, in order to boost profits, he was let go later that month. The shareholders said,
yeah,
you know, electric cars and all that stuff's great. This is not our focus.
Yeah.
And he went with it anyway. And it just became one of those things where it's like, why don't you, you know, fix kind of what you got? I mean, you've got cars out there that Ford's had for a while. It's pretty uninspired.
Yeah. And what's funny is they're mentioning, you know, fairly recent dates. And my confidence in Ford as a company has actually improved some.
Well, yeah. That's because we don't own one.
Well, yeah, that's true.
That's probably a big part of it.
But. I know. But it seems like a shiny company, and it seems like things have been doing better.
It is, but yeah. It's not as good as it could be.
And why would
a lot of people were starting to say, you know, Ford is resting on its laurels and not really showing the innovation and stuff that they should be. And, you know, I mean, you can be innovative, but I think that the shareholders thought that he was trying to take it in a direction that would not lead towards success.
I know. And, you know, trying to take on Tesla, I'm sorry. The last thing I want in the automotive industry is for the automotive industry to turn into the smartphone industry.
Yeah.
You know,
we don't need that.
So, yeah. Wow, that's pretty bad.
So you can do number five.
Oh, I don't understand how this person had power in the first place, but number five is Tiger Woods.
Well, it's because he was a super duper golf guy.
Yeah.
I mean, he had 14 major wins. That's pretty serious business.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Including
4 Masters tournaments and 3 U.S.
Okay.
Opens.
I thought I was doing number five.
Well, you said you don't understand. I'm making sure that everybody understands. That's a big deal. This guy was like the Michael Jordan of golf.
Okay.
And to put it in perspective, seriously, it's like, you know, outpacing a lot of the classic heroes of golf, like Arnold Palmer and all those guys.
I know. It's just weird because the first four were either government people or a major industry leader.
Yeah, but I mean, he's kind of fallen from grace, right?
Yeah, he has, because the latest scandal surrounds Woods in what appears to be a DUI arrest. Found by police, stopped on the side of the road early morning on Memorial Day, Woods failed a field sobriety test and was arrested. At the station, he passed a breathalyzer, however, and it was later revealed that the golfer was suffering from a dangerous combination of prescription medications. Ooh, that's bad.
Yeah.
Following the widely publicized incident, Woods checked into a clinic to help him manage his drug use. In the realm of professional golf, Woods is currently ranked 899, his lowest ranking ever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
899.
But see, this guy has been spiraling out of control, in my opinion, for a few years now.
Well, it's been longer than that. It's been like since 2009.
Because this is the third time I've read about him checking into a clinic.
Yeah.
The first time was for sexual or sex addiction. The other time was for marijuana and alcohol.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's just spiraling badly, circling the drain.
Yeah. Well, number six who's circling the drain was Kendall Jenner.
Oh, yeah.
Who does not get time on my podcast because what the hell has she done other than nothing? Right? Except made this widely criticized Pepsi advertisement in April.
Yeah.
Where she's walking away from a model shoot and she joins a generic group of protesters.
Yeah.
And then she defuses the situation with the police by what? Handing a cop a can of Pepsi.
Yeah.
It's like, really? Anyway, I don't care.
Well, that was to, I mean, I understand what they were going for, but it was a wide miss, especially during what was going on in the news at that time.
Yep.
Yeah.
This dude right here, right?
Yeah.
Number seven. Montgomery Moran.
Oh, God.
Yep.
No.
You ever heard of Chipotle?
Yes. Yes, I
Everybody
have.
Outside of New Mexico has heard of Chipotle.
Yeah.
Everybody in New Mexico doesn't really care about Chipotle.
No.
It's, like, awful. I don't like it. I mean, people think their burritos are wonderful and all that stuff. I just don't.
Every time I've eaten there, I order pretty much the similar thing, and it's always dried out and lacks flavor.
Yeah, it's just not good.
Yeah.
Well, they really had a problem, right?
Yeah.
When
the E. coli breakouts
2015 had several E. coli outbreaks, right, tied to the restaurants. 43 cases connected to Washington and Oregon.
Oh, gosh.
They overhauled its food preparation procedures in response to the outbreak, and the changes apparently weren't enough.
Yeah.
So he stepped down.
Oh.
At the end of 2016.
Shares plunged nearly 50% since October 2015.
Yep.
and revenue fell from $4.5 billion to $3.9 billion. That's really bad.
And their current CEO, Steve Ells, he may be next because there is a norovirus outbreak tied to Chipotle.
That is literally...
in Sterling, Virginia. Okay, is, you know, you eat Taco Bell?
Yeah.
There's an expectation you're going to be spending some time in the office. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Eat Chipotle? I guess you can have that same expectation. But, I mean, E. coli, norovirus, and the burritos, I mean, really aren't that good to begin with. I mean, come on, man.
But literally, like, norovirus, that is like the first thing on cans of Lysol. Kills norovirus.
Yeah. It's like,
so you can't keep your kitchens that clean. That's pretty sad. Not. So,
yeah, and that's about all we're going to do for that.
Yeah.
There are 50 of these people that you can read up on. We have some wonderful people such as Mitch McConnell.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who's a shithead.
Oh.
I don't like him.
Huh.
Never have really liked that guy so much, and he's in the Republican Party. And, you know, hey, there's some more in here. You've got Mitt Romney. Right?
Yeah.
And you also have Matthew Salzberg. From Blue Apron, Hope Solo, right? Andy Hall, probably never heard of him. He's a hedge fund manager.
Yeah.
Sean Spicer, he's in here.
Of course.
Yeah. That dude. The best part of him.
Yeah.
I think was the SNL impression that kind of went viral with Melissa McCarthy.
Yeah. I love those.
Yeah. He resigned after like 6 months.
This one, I'm surprised. All the way down at number 18 is Martin Scorsese, and we all know him as the pharma bro.
Yeah.
I have a less polite word for him, but he was the guy who jacked up the prices of AIDS medication, HIV medication, and the EpiPen.
Was he the EpiPen too? I thought that was the other lady.
EpiPen is a combination because he owns part of the patents for it. Yeah.
We're went from like $8 to $800 or something crazy like that.
Oh, well, EpiPens are expensive. They're like $200 and $200 got you like a 2-pack or something.
Yeah.
And now it's $600. $600 for an EpiPen. So one. It's terrible. This guy made me so mad.
Yeah.
What bothers me is he's all the way down here at 18, and my list of people, he'd be number one.
Dang.
Yeah, you don't mess with people's medications. I'm sorry. So
that's true.
Did you see number 19, though?
Who?
Tim Allen.
Yeah, I think he personally got a little bit of a raw deal.
Yeah.
His show was really popular on ABC.
Yeah.
And then Disney decided to go ahead and try to let it go because he was like the only conservative leaning sort of show.
Yeah.
Especially sitcom. And they just decided they were going to cancel it. Came out of nowhere. You know?
It's like, I was reading that. We didn't put it in the show notes, but one of the comedy websites has a YouTuber with a conservative leaning show where he just downs on everything in the media. And currently all these people are trying to boycott that one channel just so that they'd get him off their network.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not going to work, though.
Oh, and interesting note, number 20, John Stumpf, CEO of Wells Fargo.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's so...
Like, hey, would you like to open a credit card account? Well, no, that's okay. We've already opened one for you. So if you ever need it or anything, just let us know, and we'll just go ahead and give you a card for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, we're going to round it off with number 50.
Oh, really?
Number 50 is Hillary Clinton. And personally, honestly,
because
I don't like Hillary Clinton, and I never have because I'm, you know, served in the military back when her and her, what's his face, Bill, were in office. I don't like how they treat the military. I just don't like it, right? Because they had real personal disdain towards the military. I think she should be number one.
Yeah.
I mean, especially since she's came out with her book saying that basically it's everybody's fault but hers. As to why the campaign went south, right? And she was Secretary of State, First Lady of the United States, what she was shooting for.
Yeah.
What, or which is what she was. What are you pointing at? You're pointing at your screen. It's like 100 feet away from me. I can't see anything.
Someone else that we actually talked about on the podcast earlier.
So. Well, who?
Ja Rule. the fire festival.
Yeah, that was just, it was kind of bad. Yeah. People eating ham sandwiches like they were savages. People at a styrofoam. They're like, this is not gourmet.
The fire festival turned into what looked like a FEMA survival zone.
Yeah, they had to evacuate them and stuff. I remember that.
But yeah.
So Hillary went through all this crap. She was first lady of the United States, August. She's running, doing her thing, right? Well-financed.
Yeah.
Right? Raising a total of $1.2 billion.
Wow.
$1 billion.
Yeah.
And then you got Donald Trump, her competition, no government experience, relative limited financing backing, only raised $647 million.
Wow.
That's it. So she doubled the budget, right?
Yeah.
And despite all of her advantages and a comfortable lead in the vast majority of national polls leading up to November 4th election, Clinton lost by 74 electoral college votes to Trump in a historic upset.
Yeah.
I personally think that would make you the biggest, you know, loser, the most least powerful person out there.
Well, maybe this list is from least bad to worst.
No, this list is from a website that doesn't lean towards the conservative field of view. So
yeah.
But yeah, Ja Rule's 47. That fire festival is pretty funny. Yeah.
So they're
like, we're like seven. They were living out. They were hating it, man. They even had the igloos. Remember the igloos they were all trying to live in? They were like FEMA tents.
Well, I actually saw a couple of pictures later on, and there was like this one dude where he was sleeping on the styrofoam coolers. He broke them apart and made himself a little shelter.
Yeah, they were hurting. They showed up, and they were like people just... They also had that picture where they had the back of a truck open. They were just throwing all their bags out. So, like, you figure it out kind of a thing.
I mean, they didn't even have clean water. Nope. That's pretty bad.
Yeah.
And these are all rich kids who have never had to, you know, their only version of camping is glamping. You know?
Yeah, that was pretty funny.
I don't know. That was pretty bad. So, 50 least powerful people in the world.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Well, it's time for us to take a little break. We'll be right back, and you're listening to CheapGeek Podcast. Okay. Yeah. And we're back. Okay, so Albuquerque has been lucky enough to be one of the 30 cities to receive a community boost from Facebook.
Which...
Hold on. I'm going somewhere with this.
Okay.
Now, we live in New Mexico, and the place where Facebook is going to be opening up is not in Albuquerque. That's the first thing that I have a problem with.
But Albuquerque actually helped with the bid.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter. So, that's still not where they're located.
Yeah.
The largest town around in here, in this local area here where we are, is Albuquerque.
Mm-hmm.
And so it kind of goes through and they talk about, let me tell you what I'm talking about. So Facebook has decided they're going to have this huge data center, right?
Yeah.
And they did this in, or they're going to be doing this. I don't know if they've broken ground yet. But anyway, they're going to be doing this in Las Lunas, New Mexico.
They broke ground back in June, end of May.
Yeah, okay.
So
Mark Zuckerberg named Albuquerque as one of the 30 cities that will be part of its company's new Community Boost initiative, focusing on strengthening communities by providing small businesses with the tools to succeed. Right?
Yeah.
So other participating cities include Des Moines, Iowa, Houston, and St. Louis. 70 million small businesses use Facebook to connect with customers. Right? That's 70 million people who now have access to the same tools the big guys have. Now we need to make it easier for people to start and build new businesses or find jobs and opportunities, and in the process, strengthen their communities.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, that sounds neat. Right? So there's going to be a $500 million Facebook data center that's expected to create several hundred new jobs in the area. And Las Lunas officials told a local news here, KOB, that they're already seeing dividends from one of the world's biggest companies.
Yeah.
Right? Arriving in the land of enchantment in part of the state where the tech science industry has already has a considerable presence via the Sandia and Los Alamos National Labs. That's great. What I would like to say is a lot of those people that man Los Alamos and Sandia Labs aren't from here. They're from other places.
Yes.
This place is not nearly as tech savvy as people think it is.
Yes.
If by tech savvy you mean contact center or call center or something like that, then sure. You know, we came from a place in Virginia where we have ex-military. We're talking like, you know, everything from, you know, flight engineers to fighter pirates. Fighter pilot. I mean, we have this, you know, a pretty wide technical sort of pool to draw from. And I haven't really seen it here in this place.
We have a wide and very strong established technical background for most people in the area that we're from.
Yeah.
In Virginia. Everyone there has that technical background, and technology was incorporated into their jobs a very long time ago, over two decades. So there's a technical advantage over there on the East Coast. Now, Facebook claiming that they're going to provide this influx of tools to provide digital education and skills that communities need to compete in the new mobile economy, it is a very polite way of saying, we have found a way to take advantage of small business owners. Why? Because, yes, this community boost program on the back end, since I am a social media manager, I've looked at it. There's a lot of good marketing tools. They've tweaked some algorithms, and they've done some stuff that is pretty good. But unless you know what you're working with, it is just a way to waste $50 to $200 to $300 a month, or even in a week if you're really that dumb.
Or a campaign.
Yeah.
Like in one shot.
On a campaign. Yeah. Or there's ways on Facebook now where you can actually put your business as a recommended or suggested business whenever anybody looks at anything.
Yeah.
And
got to pay to play, though.
In their search results or anything. But it requires you, the small business owner, to fill out your profile correctly, set up your page correctly, all these things that you need to do before you can market that sort of stuff. Facebook has not created a community boost program in the sense that they're providing people with training.
Nope.
No.
They're just providing you a way to go ahead and pay some monies.
Yeah.
You know, to have your ad campaigns run, along with some of the special tools that you can use for that, but there's no knowledge there.
And here's the thing. The data center that they're putting in place maybe will hire 50 people to start off.
Yeah.
50 to start off, and they're all data engineers and basically babysitters for servers.
Pretty much.
They're looking to bring their marketing call center here, and gosh forbid that happens, because as much as some of us don't like calling India or other countries, at least those people know the tools that they're working with.
Yeah. And I like what the mayor said.
Yeah.
We are excited and welcome Facebook to Albuquerque. This is Mayor Richard Berry, right? And this is after Zuckerberg made a statement. It's like, you know, this initiative will help train our residents in developing key skills to help them thrive in our ever-evolving digital world.
No, because you actually need training to do that.
Yeah, well, we hope this will bring more tech skills and better job opportunities to our wonderful community. See? We hope this will bring more tech skills and job opportunities to our wonderful community.
How?
Because bring people in.
You know,
not going to train the people that are here. Let's bring people in from the outside like they always do.
Albuquerque lost Amazon. Amazon used to have a fulfillment center here plus another center here. And they lost them because the people that they hired for their fulfillment staff couldn't understand the technology or the system in place that Amazon used to fulfill orders.
Yep.
Because when you hire warehouse workers, literally there are still million-dollar companies here with fulfillment buildings where they're still looking at notebook, you know, pieces of notebook paper.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm just angry.
Well, I mean, and that's what they should be doing. I mean, honestly, there should be training that happens to bring people into the 21st, 22nd century, if you will.
No.
And they're not doing it. You know, they're bringing businesses in, trying to recruit them, court them to get them to be here. And then you have statements like that will help bring more tech skills and better job opportunities to our wonderful community. Why not start up a technology think tank where they can start training these people?
Oh, well, there are think tanks.
No, like, but I mean a technology think tank where they actually train you. Most of them talk about something, you buy into it.
Well,
and so, you really don't get any real training out of it. So it's like I've seen this. So you know, they're trying to bring Amazon back, right?
Yeah.
They're trying to do all this stuff, and it's like, what are they actually telling these companies to get them to show up? And you know, really what brings these big companies here is either the incentives that are put out to them by the state, right?
Yeah.
And how low they pay their people here.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, and it's comparable. Everybody pays about the same for this particular area, and it's really low.
And that's the thing. If you just up that pay, that rate of pay by maybe a quarter, like literally 25 cents.
No, make it a dollar.
A dollar's a bit high.
Well, no, because you can do a dollar for bilingual.
Okay, so you take a dollar and you go move your call center or fulfillment center or anything like that to, let's just say, Provo, Utah, or someplace in Wyoming, where you have bilingual people and you have people. Those people, believe it or not, their tech skills are a lot stronger.
No, I believe it.
You know, and you were mentioning that there's no think tanks. There are a very few small entities. They're called business incubators. And there's two down in Albuquerque. You want to know how much they want to charge you just to learn how to use Etsy?
How much?
$200 to $300.
Per session?
No, that's for 6 weeks.
Ah.
And there's four classes.
Huh.
So, and that's just to learn how to use it as a small business owner.
It's actually not that bad.
I know. But small business owners out here, because everybody's got a small business. Everybody's got a great idea.
Everybody's got a side hustle.
Yeah. Everybody has a side hustle. They don't have enough. They don't have the money for that.
Yeah.
And we're talking about, you know, these small groups of individuals. Whereas if you go back home to Virginia, anybody could list something on Etsy or eBay. Anybody can set up a Facebook fan page.
Yeah.
Anybody. You know? And we don't have that here.
I like some of the comments. Right.
Yeah.
In other words, Zuck will import and release thousands of Russian bears with ad signs and cameras into the Los Lunas area, giving things a boost.
Well, yeah. I think
and this one
guy's
all mad. He's like, and they only have a handful of employees. Right? And so Los Lunas is a new Albuquerque. I hope it means Facebook will be paying for art because the federal government
and
isn't.
That's the twist. So when Facebook was looking for places to land, Los Lunas ended up on the bid because of their land prices. Because right. Albuquerque was like, no. When Los Lunas announced that they were in the bidding, Albuquerque invested in Los Lunas.
Yep.
So, I don't know. I just think the top comment, though, right there, 290 points, because apparently you can upvote comments on this page. Whatever that means.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and the land is cheap. Yeah. And they had all sorts of special water deals and stuff like that going down to get them into the area.
Yeah.
I mean, look, I'm glad Facebook is coming here. Even though we know that there's not going to be like these 500, 600, you know, they were saying all these jobs are going to show up and...
Yeah.
Sure, during the building process and maybe some maintenance side of it, but when it comes to actually working in the data center, it's going to be a whole lot less people than they actually thought.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what to think of all this, so, really.
Oh.
You know, it's a community boost, though. We're going to show you how to pay for Facebook ads.
And they're not even showing you. I mean...
No, they're just,
they're just
talking
like,
about it.
They've just released the technology to these areas.
Kind of like what happened with our next story.
Oh, really?
And this is something I've been kind of paying attention to off and on.
Mm-hmm.
You know those big giant wind turbines that everybody seems to love?
Yeah.
Yeah, they suck. I mean, there's lots of awful things attached to these wind turbines, right?
Really?
Yeah. They kill birds, you know?
Okay.
And the big thing is, with a lot of these, is they actually make these, they make noise.
Hmm.
These things are huge. These huge windmills, right? These wind turbines out there.
Yeah.
Well, they make noise, and that's the big reason why a lot of people don't want them after the fact. See, everybody really wants them. They're like, oh, we'll be all green and everything, right? These things make a huge amount of noise.
Oh.
Yeah. Like, thump, 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 you know, because they're huge, right? They typically got three little blades on them.
Yeah.
You know, and they kind of flop around, and they kind of make that sort of chopping noise, right?
Yeah.
Well, in Vermont, right, they have these wind turbines, and they have to come up with new power sound rules. So Vermont utility regulators had to settle the long-standing contentious issue of how much noise, right?
Yeah.
They can basically make. Because, you know, you've got these industrial wind projects, man, that they kind of have to, you put them in place, everything is great, but then after a while, the people that live around the area hate it. Because it makes so much noise, so they wind up suing them, and it goes to court, and they have to kind of work out some kind of arrangement.
Yeah.
And so proponents of using industrial wind projects, like those big wind turbines we're talking about, and this is in Vermont, right?
Yeah.
They have a long-term goal of getting 90% of its power from renewable resources by 2050.
Yeah.
And now they're saying, well, these new wind rules will make achieving that goal more difficult, if not impossible.
So
what they're trying to say is like, oh, well, if you enact these rules that we're trying to have enacted upon us, then we're not going to be able to make the, you know, our goal of 90%. Power coming from renewable. And so, but see, here's the real thing is, it's wind noise rule, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is what they have to adhere to. They have a new rule set where they have to be able to reduce the amount of noise from like a daytime limit of 42 decibels.
Yeah.
When these are the sounds from the turbines when they're near a home.
Yeah.
And 39 decibels at night.
Okay.
And they're trying to say that the decibel level measures sound intensity. That's what the decibel does, right? It's how intense the sound is. And experts are saying that 40 decibels is the rough equivalent of a library.
Okay.
No, it's not.
It's not?
No.
Oh.
But see, whenever you put these things up and the wind starts blowing and you get the wind that blows them and that sort of thing, right, it makes a large amount of noise. And when you put like 5, 10, 15 of these things going, man, they make a lot of noise. And that sound carries, man. And if you're living close to it, you know, you're going to hate it.
So I have a friend who actually lives out near the Mount Taylor ones.
Yeah.
And here in New Mexico, there is a wind farm out near Mount Taylor, and you can actually see it from the Sandia Mountains, which is kind of cool.
Yep.
But we never actually went to the wind farm because I guess it's like locked away and stuff.
Yeah.
But there is a noticeable hum.
That's part of it too.
That neighborhood. Well, it's not even a neighborhood. It's more like a land grant or whatever they call them. So, yeah, we would notice that hum when she'd go driving around out there. And it didn't bother me, but we were about 4 miles away.
Yeah.
You know? Plus a mountain.
They're just loud, man.
Yeah.
You know, and you get those huge turbines going around like whoop, whoop, whoop. And there's been instances like one couple is like, we built a soundproof bedroom with 12-inch thick walls just so we could sleep.
That's,
you know,
yeah,
and they're trying to say, hey, this really isn't a veto of wind in Vermont. It's just a challenge, right?
Yeah,
and they want to make sure that they kind of lower the decibels. And I get it, you know. And a lot of people like they love these things. They're like, well, you know, why do you hate the planet? You should have these wind farms everywhere. Why do you hate the planet? Because they are relatively inefficient. They're a stupid design. They cost a lot of money to maintain, and that's a big reason why a lot of these wind farms, you know, they hire so many people, which the economy likes.
Yeah.
Because they're dumb. A vertical access wind turbine will make less money, takes up less footprint, and kills less animals.
Didn't we talk about those on the podcast? The big tall things with no...
No blades. They just kind of spin around. Yeah. Looks like a trash can spinning around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and
they're way quieter than these things. Foomp, foomp, foomp.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I heard you get paid good money if you know how to repair those things.
So, well, yeah. Sure.
I was like,
It's just, and they have to be kind of tall to get up in the air, to get up where the wind blows, you know, all that kind of stuff. But
yeah,
it's just a kind of a dumb design. And a lot of people don't think about, you know, some of the not so wonderful features of the wind turbine is the noise.
So I was looking.
They're loud.
Yeah.
You know, they have to make them quieter. So how are they going to make them quieter? I don't know. I don't really know how they do that sort of thing. Maybe change the gearing in them or something like that. But I wouldn't want one of those things hanging out where we live because it'd be loud as hell.
I was looking
especially
at...
Especially if it's really windy, man. Those things get whipping around. Yep.
I was looking at the Industrial Noise Control website, and it compares quiet rural areas. So I guess, you know, walking through the countryside is at 30 decibels.
Yeah.
A library is at 40 decibels. Lowest limit of urban ambient sound. Bird calls are at 44 decibels.
Yep.
So, I don't know. 42 decibels is just slightly lower than bird calls.
It'd be like highway noise. Well, all the time.
Highway noise is actually at 60. No.
Okay, well, yeah. Maybe not popular highway noise, like the heavily populated area type thing.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. I like these two comments I read. These are very low frequency sound waves that are unhealthy. And anyone who lives near one of these wind farms will tell you that virtually all the wildlife have left the area. That's true. I have read that
in
lots of places. And this other comment from Fritz, 3197. The good socialist from Vermont should be given earplugs. After all, the progressives tell us that the earth is more important.
I wonder if that low decibel sound causes hearing damage.
Yes, it does. It's low frequency.
Like persistent?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So...
I mean, it's always the dose that makes a poison with anything, but yeah, low frequency can cause hearing loss. So can high frequencies, but sustained exposure over time is really what causes those issues.
Man, that's not good. Yeah.
Yeah. That's like you can hear a thunder rumble like 8 miles away. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of it, because low frequency, you have a tendency to travel faster, better, stronger than high frequency. Low frequency is much longer in duration. High frequency is sort of quick and sharp. It's sort of weird. Yep.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, it's like, I it's the sound, man. That would drive me nuts. I'd be super aggravated.
Well, that's like, I don't ever want to live near power lines, not because of the brain damage and all the other stuff, but because the noise that they make.
The hum.
Yeah.
The buzz.
It really, it's a buzz. It's not a hum, and it kind of makes me really angry. Antsy and uncomfortable.
Well, I mean, yeah, it can. That buzz and can cause all sorts of issues and problems and, you know, it has different effects on people. I mean, if you do a constant noise or subject people to a constant noise continuously, it really depends on the individuals how they're going to react to it.
Mm-hmm.
So some people go crazy. Some people just, you know, I mean, it kind of is what it is. It's like, you know, I don't know.
Certain noises make me go nuts. Like, I get really angry and frustrated and I can't describe it. Like, that hum is one of them, and so is car doors. Like when you leave your car door open, it just makes me very frustrated.
You mean the ding?
Yes.
It's very nice. Cool.
Yep.
Well, okay. I think what we're going to do is take a quick break. We'll come back, and I have a little bit of a rant. I read this today, and I'm, you know, I kind of talk to you about it in a minute. But, you know, yeah, it kind of is what it is, so we will just kind of see what happens. So anyway, take a little break. We'll be right back.
Audible is an audio entertainment that entertains, educates, and inspires. For you, the listeners of the Cheap Geek Podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. To download your free audiobook today, go to audibletrial.com/CheapGeek. Again, that's audibletrial.com/CheapGeek for your free audiobook.
And we're back. So I was thinking about some things the other day, and I was kind of coming across a sort of a theme, you know, looking for a podcast type theme. And I got a little train wrecked because I read this little, I didn't hear about this, but then I kind of, after I started reading it, you know.
Oh, I heard about it.
I kind of found out about it.
Yeah.
And I seen this picture, and they're calling this lady the middle finger lady. She's the one that basically is riding her bicycle, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the Trump motorcade is going past her, President Trump's motorcade. And she has her just, you know, hanging the middle finger in the air. Right?
Yeah.
And it's kind of like this. So they started calling her the middle finger lady.
Okay.
And this goes to my rant section that I call dipshittery. Okay? Because the lady's name is Juli Briskman.
Mm-hmm.
And I found a couple articles and stuff like that. And what really sort of got me... sort of thinking about it, is she has a GoFundMe page, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, are you kidding me? And I found a link, and I started reading up on this little, you know, different spots here and there. And there's 5 fast facts that you need to know about this lady.
Mm-hmm.
And she's from Virginia, and she was fired from her job after a photo of her flipping off Donald Trump's motorcade went viral.
Yeah.
Now, during an interview with the Huffington Post, she said, she's 50, Juli said that she had been let go from her government contractor job at Acoma LLC.
That's a good job.
Yeah. And the photo was taken outside Trump's golf course in Sterling, Virginia on Halloween evening. And after the photo began to spread, Briskman contacted her employees to let them know that she was the cyclist in the photo, giving the middle finger to Trump's row of SUVs. Mm-hmm. Right? When asked by Washington Post if she regretted her action, she, you know, Briskman, a mother of two, said, "I'd do it again."
Yeah.
Okay. Well, she changed her Facebook, her social media profile as this picture. And then she contacted her employees, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, her employers. And then, you know, they talk about different things like Briskman says or directed her company called, basically called, okay, and not to get into too much detail.
Yeah.
She starts kind of pointing the finger at the company saying that they didn't equally apply their policy when they let her go. And then there's some couple interviews with her, and she basically blames them for firing her, that she shouldn't have been fired, she should have been treated just the same as anybody else. And there's been instances in the past where people weren't fired. I'm like, okay, this keeps going back to people do stuff, and they are genuinely shocked when it doesn't work out the way they think. They get punished, they get penalized, they get fined, they get fired.
Yeah.
It's like, how can you blame this on everybody else? You did it. Your company has a government contract.
She's saying
she's also in frickin' Virginia. Yeah. It's a right to work state where, and they have their policy, right?
And it's Sterling, Virginia, where there's a Chipotle outbreak of norovirus.
What? See what happens there? And it kind of keeps going, but you know, their policy, right? Yeah. The company's policy that fired her is covered social media activity that contains discriminatory, obscene, malicious, or threatening content is knowingly false, creates a hostile work environment, or similar inappropriate or unlawful conduct will not be tolerated, mm-hmm. and will be subject to discipline up to and including termination of employment.
You know what?
So
this social media policy that they're stating right here, there's no date on it. And her example of a director acting inappropriately on social media also has no date on it.
Right.
So if one of her roles at Acoma is to be in charge of the company's Facebook page, then she should be aware of some dates and when things get enacted. Plus, this was a senior company director that she is comparing to. And his quotes, again, he's responsible. He was taken aside, and he was given the opportunity to clean up his Facebook page.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure not long after this is when the social media got put in place, the social media policy. So
it doesn't matter. It was put in place before she did what she did.
Yeah. So
because Acoma's Human Resource Department told Briskman in a meeting that her posting on Facebook and Twitter was in violation of the company's social media policy. And that's according to the interview that she gave Huffington Post on November 4th, right?
Yeah.
And she said, they said, "We're separating from you. Basically, you cannot have lewd or obscene things in your social media."
Hmm.
So they were calling flipping him off as being obscene.
Yeah.
It's like, okay.
So, okay. I see nothing wrong with that policy.
Yeah. So. And state law in Virginia, right, indicates that employers can fire employees at any time for any reason. It's a right to work state.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. And so going forward, Briskman says that she may look for a new job at Planned Parents or an advocacy group that she believes in.
Good luck getting paid what she used to get paid.
Well, she's also working with the ACLU in a case against her former employers, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me tell you what's going to happen. They're not going to win.
Nope.
It's a right-to-work state. She broke their policy. It doesn't matter if she thought that she didn't break their policy. The company thought she broke the policy.
Yep.
And they don't have to put up with it.
No.
She would have been better off if she just pulled her little bicycle over to the side and took a knee. You know? And there's all sorts of pictures here. You know, like she's doing yoga somewhere in Washington. You can see Washington Monument in the background. I think that's Lincoln.
I think that's Lincoln's memorial from there.
And she's got all this stuff going on, you know, and she's, you know, here's the deal, Juli. You exercise your First Amendment rights.
Good for
Fantastic.
You.
Now you have to put up with the consequences, whether you like them or not.
Yeah.
And this is what happens. And to anybody else out there, if you want a reaction of what it would be like, if you're wanting, you know, what it'd be like to send a, go to your parents and flip them off and see what happens. You know?
Yeah.
Go find a cop and flip him off and see what happens.
Actually, no, because cops are now in training because they can't.
You know what? One of them has a reflex and just punches you in the nose.
Yeah, that's
my
true.
Point is think about it for a second. You flip off the presidential motorcade. It doesn't matter if you think you're right or wrong. Because if you do it, you better be ready to put up with the details. Or, you know, you have to live with the consequences. Because the details, that's where the devil lives. And in her case, her little reflex that she did, right? Forgot all about that company policy, man. And here's the deal, everybody. Your social media profile, whether you think it's yours or not, when you're employed by a company these days in the year 2017, and you have crap in your Facebook profile, or you have crap on your social media, and they think that reflects badly on that company, and most companies here in the U.S. are not charities, they're going to fire your ass. And you're going to go ahead and spend all your money trying to fight what you already agreed to. Most companies have these electronic policies and stuff like that because, hey, you know what's going to happen, right? If you are acting on behalf of the company, you can be held accountable. Well, that kind of goes between, you know, what they do and what you do
and
what you agree to.
She uploaded this picture while she was at work.
Yeah.
Which is another violation for most people's social media policies,
yeah.
Most companies' social media policies. If she uploaded this while she was at work or about to log into work or whatever you call it, that's a major violation.
I kind of think that once she did it and it started to kind of go a little bit viral, that she figured she better get ahead of it so she could capitalize this as best she can.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of think that if you own a company and you have an employee doing this and it violates your policy, well, then you need to take care of that. And they did. And I kind of think if you're going to be a big person and get out there and show your ass and show how you really feel, then you have to put up with the consequences. I don't think it's the company's fault that they fired her. She may think that they were wrong for firing her, but I mean, based off what I'm seeing, it looks like she just went ahead and violated her policy anyway.
Yeah.
And, you know, and she's been interviewed already, and now she's got this GoFundMe page where people are thinking she's a hero. Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, not a hero, a shero. Because she, you know, basically expressed herself by riding her bicycle along the side of the road and having a middle finger to the president's motorcade.
Yeah.
That makes you a hero? It doesn't make you an inspiration to all.
No.
You know? But you can show your support by donating to this woman. Right? Because right now she's got $56,485 of a $100,000 goal.
Oh,
sorry, man. I don't think you're a hero. I think you're kind of a dipshit.
Oh.
And she seemed to be genuinely shocked that she was fired.
People are literally donating as we speak. Now it's all the way up to $56,505.
Ooh.
But here's the thing. Of a goal of $100,000.
Yeah.
And you know what? Considering this is a government contract job for a good government company, and this is in Sterling, Virginia, that's barely 1 year's salary.
That's okay, because she's also a Sunday school teacher, so.
Yeah. Oh, and I think I donated to Clean Water once. The end of this article goes on to talk about how wonderful of a person she is.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, I don't care if you donated to Clean Water or that you've done all this other stuff. If you're a Sunday school teacher, the parents at the Sunday school probably don't want to see you flipping birds or encouraging their kids to flip birds.
Yeah.
So,
you know, hey, but that's okay. She has every right to. And she also has every right to put up the consequences.
Yeah.
You can protest all you want. I don't have to like it. Neither does their company, right?
Yeah.
And it goes back to you have First Amendment rights. Absolutely. You can exercise them all you want. Absolutely. Just be ready to put up the consequences. Being shocked and now she's ready to sue. It's like, what? You fired me for something I did.
Oh, and then this article is exposing things about the company Acoma.
Well, hold on. It gets even better. And here's where I think that this lady is full of shit.
Yeah.
When asked about her reasons for flipping off the president, mm-hmm. Briskman told the Huffington Post he was passing by and my blood just started to boil. I'm thinking DACA recipients are getting kicked out, right? Are getting kicked out. He pulled ads for open enrollment in Obamacare.
Mm-hmm.
Only a third of Puerto Rico has power. I'm thinking he's at the damn golf course again. So I flipped off the motorcade a number of times. And in some ways, I'm doing better than ever. I'm angry about where our country is going right now. I'm appalled. This was an opportunity for me to say something.
You didn't say anything.
He didn't say anything. He looked like a dipshit.
Yeah.
He couldn't hear you. You should have took a knee. It's like, okay.
Yeah, and then the part of this article just trashes the company that fired her. Which,
basically.
Yeah, I'm sorry. They've contributed.
Look at that. Government contractor Acma LLC just fired Juli Briskman for exercising freedom of speech on her own time.
Yeah.
But did not fire a male employee for a similar incident. Can we stop doing business with them? Really?
All right. Bye.
No. You can't stop doing business. It's part of a contract.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
A lot of bullshit with this.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's not a hero. Sorry.
Yeah.
I have heroes. They're veterans.
Yes.
And the veterans that we supported yesterday for Veterans Day, people go out there and they do what they got to do to take care of business. You know? And people are like, well, you know, I don't support the wars or whatever. Who cares? I do. I support the veterans, right?
Yeah.
Got to support the country. These people, they swear to an oath to defend the country, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and people think they're oppressed and they're not oppressed and all this other stuff goes down. But you know what, though? The people who go out there and put their money where their mouth is for a lot of occasions and a lot of situations and a lot of just, you know, just overall bad stuff, veterans.
Yeah.
They do what they got to do. Take care of business. Yeah.
Because when it comes down to it, doesn't matter how you feel about the country. Hopefully you actually love the country. When it comes down to it, the whole military and everything down that, it comes down to that one veteran or that one military person you know. They're just an average Joe who made an incredible sacrifice.
Yep.
And chose to do something bigger than themselves.
And you know what else? You know who's not allowed to express their First Amendment rights?
Active duty military?
That is correct.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Mm-hmm.
Well, good job, Juli, out there riding around, flicking people off. I mean, you know, here's the thing. I guess I wouldn't flick people off just riding around just because. The only time I ever flick anybody off is if they are actively trying to kill me, as in run into me.
Yeah.
Or have tried to run into me. But, you know, I don't just ride around and make it a point. I mean, you know, hey. People got no respect these days.
Yeah.
You know? Like yesterday. We're riding down the road. That guy's got his gas door open and the gas thing hanging in the breeze or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And so I yelled at him. He could have easily flicked me off, which is the first reaction that happens here in New Mexico, right?
Yeah.
What'd he do?
Oh, thanks, man.
Oh, man, thanks, man. Because I was like, hey, bro. All loud and stuff. I was like, gas door's open. Oh, hey, man, thanks, man. Yeah. See? Courtesy goes a long way.
No.
I don't know.
It doesn't exist anymore.
Well, I guess not.
No.
But I'm telling you, man, the shooter took a knee. Been all over the, she wouldn't have got fired then.
Hmm.
See?
Maybe she would have got a.
And it would have furthered the other movement that, what's his face? How do you say his name?
Kaepernick.
Kaepernick.
Mm-hmm.
It would have furthered that cause even further. It would have tied in the protest to make sense. No, you have a lady riding a bicycle with her stupid looking helmet with her middle finger in the air. Hmm. Like every other angry soccer mom you ever see riding a bicycle. Right? You can't approach, you got to be careful, can't approach them. So I don't know. I was like, well, there you go. There you go.
Yeah. Okay, then.
A little dipshittery.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even a good picture. I still think, though, she's trying to capitalize on all this. Once she knew she was going to get fired, or she thought she was going to get fired, because as soon as she posted on Twitter and Facebook and changed her her profile image to this, she knew what was going to happen.
I know.
I mean, come on, if you were worried about being fired, if you really want to keep your job, you'd hope nobody's seen that, especially after thinking about it. So, I don't know. It'd be interesting to see what happens when she goes to court. So,
yeah. And good luck with that GoFundMe, because literally, it says in the description, you know, all proceeds are being donated directly to Juli. There's got to be some taxes that have to get taken out of that.
Yeah.
Have to be. I mean, you can't just give money just because she flipped a bird.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's not sick. She's not dying. So, yeah.
She also participated in a women's march.
I know. I read that, too. She held up a sign in front of the CIA office or something.
Yeah, she's a Facebook social justice warrior.
Yeah.
Nice.
SJWs. So, yeah.
Anyway, there you go.
Mm-hmm.
Thought that was a little funny. It's like, what? I can't. Why'd you fire me? You didn't fire the other guy. Well,
The other guy's also a senior director of the company.
And see, and here's something too, man.
Yeah.
She went from having like 40 Facebook followers or 17 or whatever it was, 14 followers, to having like 16,000 Twitter followers. Not Facebook, but Twitter.
Yeah.
And right after that, well, it's time to capitalize.
Of course it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go. Now, just so you know, if you're riding down the road and you flip me off, you know, I might throw my coffee cup at you. I'm just saying.
Hmm. Is that your freedom of expression?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Maybe it'll have a couple cigarette butts in it, too. Wouldn't that be gross?
Maybe some pumpkin spice.
That's not a... No, not in my car. No, that stuff tastes like sweat.
No, just
pumpkin
deliberately...
Pumpkin spice is awful.
Deliberately drive to
just
Starbucks.
Drive around with just an old pumpkin spice somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah, no. Not paying six bucks on that.
This one's aged 3 days in my hot car.
Yeah. Telling you, though. Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah.
So, that's all I got to say about that.
Okay.
So, what's happening next on the Bingeworthy BS? Actually, we kind of got to talk about the little folk, don't we?
Yeah, we do. We
this
should.
Podcast is running long.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
So, little folk, apparently... Oh. Well, okay. I didn't read this article. I can say that little folk were really big with my mom. When I was growing up, she had all sorts of fairy books and stuff like that, including those ones from the 70s in that one place in England where it showed fairy folk photos.
Yeah.
Yeah. So every time I hear about that and I hear about places in England, that's what I think about. So what's this article about, though?
It's about little folk.
Okay.
It tells a story of, this is in Staffordshire.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And it talks about, I think it's in 1975, this couple, a married couple in their late 20s, Barry and Elaine, they had two children. And
yeah.
You can read this on mysteriousuniverse.org. They were coming home from a Christmas party.
Yeah.
And as the pair headed towards the small village, right?
Yeah.
Their car began to sputter, the engine, you know, kind of thing, sort of just died.
Okay.
Car died. And they managed to get to the side of the road, and basically Barry got out to open the hood to take a look at the engine.
Yeah.
And he says, even though I'm mainly useless at mechanical stuff, so, right?
Yeah.
There were no loose wires, radiator was fine, everything was good.
That kind of sounds like an alien abduction.
Sort of.
Or a lost time type episode. Yeah.
And so, yeah. Basically take a look at it. It says, but the family was really, they were about, I don't know, it says less than half a mile or so from the home.
Mm-hmm.
And so Barry made a decision. He said, we had a picnic blanket in the boot, which means trunk, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he got it out. He got back to the car and told Elaine, hey, let's cover you and the kids up with a blanket. And they were back in the back sleeping, this little kids. He said, you stay with them. I'll run back home and get your car and pick them up, and then they'll go from there.
Yeah.
Okay, so they weren't that far from the house.
Okay.
So at that point, however, their plans were thrown into complete and utter disarray because, according to Barry, Elaine let out a loud scream, terrified by the sight of a small figure that ran across the road in front of them at a high rate of speed.
Mm-hmm.
It says, I just about saw it at the last second, and then another one followed it, and then a third. The best way I can describe this was like a hairy troll or something like that.
Yeah.
And it said, we had some moonlight, and they looked like, you know, they were little men, but, you know, hunchbacks, big hooked noses, and not a stitch of clothes on them.
Ew. Okay.
Just hair all over them. Like Italian people. Like hairy Italian guys.
No. 4 feet tall.
Yeah, 4 feet. It's like, and she said, I would say they're all, you know, 4 feet tallish. When the third one crosses, you could see them by the edge of the trees, like wary or something, like they were looking to see, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, things became very hazy. We both know from memory that they came forwards towards us very slowly. And I thought since that they were interested in us, but, you know, or maybe they just wanted to know who we were. And they came very slowly. And it was something like we were being hunted. Elaine was hysterical and the kids with us. And I wasn't far off either. But that's all we remember.
Oh.
Right? The next moment, it's all gone. Nothing. Neither of us remember seeing them go. And the next thing, it was like 2 o'clock and the car started fine.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It felt like something had happened to us, but I couldn't quite put my finger on it. But the memory thing is the biggest problem. What was it? Did I have a dream? You know, so in other words, they lost time.
Yeah.
Right?
Like an alien abduction.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's like, you know, but there they were. We did see them right up by the stone house, right, which is a large old abode.
Mm-hmm.
It sits on the edge of the village of, village of Slitting Mill, and dates go back to 1584. So,
yeah.
What I kind of want to know what happened, right? So Barry states to this day, and that, you know, both him and his wife are both in the mid-60s, right?
Mm-hmm.
They still feel very uneasy about the loss of the memory that they both experienced back in 1975.
Yeah.
I know, and we know, that we both saw them. The kids don't remember a thing, but they were horrible little things. All that hair.
Ugh.
See?
That's kind of scary. It's
details like that you remember, yeah. Right? So neither Barry nor Elaine have experienced any further incidents or encounters of the unknown. They've never forgotten about those disturbing events deep in the heart of Slitting Mill on that chilly winter night with the strange band of hairy trolls.
Okay.
And the reason why I put this in there is because I thought about it, and I know what you're talking about, the picture of the fairies in the 30s and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And this, the little people, right, the fairy folk, the wee folk, all of that, I mean, that's not just like in England, you know?
Yeah.
That's everywhere. You've got like Norway and over in like New Zealand, they have them. I mean, it's like everywhere you have these little, and they talk about like, you know, the fairies and the trolls and all that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just, you know, kind of weird. And if you do a little bit of research, man, you start seeing more and more, like the more you dig into it, the more you hear about these little, you know, reports happening all over the place. And it's kind of the same thing. You know, people lose time. You know, they lose memory. They lose time. They don't really know what to expect. And it's sort of, you know, and that's kind of how, what was his name that fell asleep for like 80 years?
Rip Van Winkle?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, no way. So I started to, and we're probably going to do some research about fairy folk and little people and talk about some of the different reports all over the world at every time.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you ever see anything like that, watch out, man. Don't accept any food.
Or
don't accept any gifts.
Yeah.
If you run into the little folk, the wee folk, the fairy people, don't do it.
Yeah.
Don't accept any of that stuff. Because, see, once you get into their world, time passes differently there.
Yep.
So, no gifts, no food, no nothing, no drink, no nothing.
Yeah. Even if it's water.
Yep.
Yeah. Bad news if it's water. Or.
Yeah.
Like a sweet nectar drink.
And there's all sorts of myths and stuff that go around this, you know, like how to defeat them, you know. And it's all sorts of weird stuff. Like, you know, if you really want to occupy them, like, you know, leave your shoes untied, you know, by the fireplace hearth. And if you have the little folk, the little people, they'll tie your shoes and just kind of stuff like that. So I kind of wanted to throw that in there because it's something that we're going to start looking at and talking about.
Yeah.
And doing a little bit of research on. So sort of a predecessor there or whatever. So we'll do. So, and I started to do some research to throw a couple more stories in, but there's tons of them.
Yeah. Now, as far as Bingeworthy BS is concerned, everybody knows Stranger Things 2 came out.
Yes.
Supernatural is on the CW, as are The Flash. They're a little slow to release the episodes, but that's what we're watching right now. A bunch of good things are coming up. Longmire's coming soon, as are some other shows.
I like Longmire.
But I would like to put a put a call out to our listeners. I'm looking for paranormal documentaries, paranormal and cryptozoology documentaries that you enjoy. Greg and I have been flipping through Amazon and even YouTube and Google, and we're just not finding stuff that catches our eye.
Yeah, so, most of it's kind of shitty.
Yeah. I mean, it's not shitty. I appreciate those people for putting the work that they put in, but it's not. Nothing is grabbing us, and nothing is engaging us. We did watch one recently that we'll talk about in a future podcast episode, and that was Patient 17.
Yeah, that was actually pretty good.
Yeah, I enjoyed that one. So anything kind of in that strain or, you know, in that style is what I'd like to hear about. If you have any suggestions on good ones, let us know.
Yeah.
You can email us, or you can give us a call. It'd be really cool if you gave us a call at 575-208-4025.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So anything else?
No, that's really about it. You can get a hold of us on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
If you'd like to send us an email, you can certainly do that. Just do cheapgeek.net@gmail.com.
Okay.
That works really well.
Yeah.
You know, same thing, business inquiries, whatever.
Yeah.
Just use that.
And attention.
You can our Facebook group.
Yeah, put Attention Podcast or Attention Greg and Omi.
Yep.
Yeah. Follow us on Facebook, our Facebook page. We post stuff regularly, including the podcast, as well as cool photos and stuff that we're doing.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's really about it.
Yeah.
So anyway, there you go. Any questions, comments, concerns, let us know. If you're listening to us on iTunes or Google Play or SoundCloud or Stitcher or TuneFM or iHeartRadio, very much appreciated. Yep. If you listen to us on YouTube, also very much appreciated. Questions, comments, concerns are welcome. If you have any ideas you'd like us to talk about or actually try to do some like for real research, just, you know, we do a little bit and go, yeah, that's interesting, kind of move on. Just let us know. But other than that, that's really about all I got. Do you have anything else?
No.
I like
very nice. So anyway, whoa.
Music credit for this podcast goes to Kevin MacLeod at incompetech.com, licensed under Creative Commons by Attribution 3.0 license.
Like yeah, very yeah. nice. So anyway, thanks for listening. See you later. Take it easy. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I like peanut butter, I like peanut butter, peanut butter, I like peanut butter.